And welcome to ETF Edge, your go-to place for everything exchange traded funds. I'm your host, Bob Pisani. Today, joined by Nick Colas of DataTrek and Andrew McCormick of Wallach Beth. We are approaching the end of the first half of the year, and the S&P 500 is up 17%, hovering right at record highs. Let's take a look at some of the big winners in the ETF space over that time. What a diverse group here. Invesco's solar ETF up more than 50%. The IPO market has been red hot, that ETF up nearly 40%. There's the ARK Genomic ETF up 35%. And then they'll check out some of the country ETFs that have been moving, particularly in the emerging market space, Greece and Argentina, both up more than 30%. Will the momentum continue? What can we expect as we enter the second half of the year? You know, I was thinking here, Andrew, this is a pretty diverse group here. I don't think there's any thematic rhyme or reason for this.
No, and the emerging market stocks, obviously, is just a play on how low they were.
Yeah.
And it's still a risk doing that and picking those countries. Obviously, you have liquidity concerns. Make sure you're trading them when those countries are open, if you can.
Yeah.
Obviously, you can't do that in Asia, but in the case of Greece, do it when Europe's open. I don't really see much kind of more growth there or other than just betting on a total emerging market play. But the TAN and the solar one, that's interesting. That's kind of an ESG play if you really look at
it.
But
they could just as easily be down the next quarter, too.
Correct.
I mean, this is what makes me crazy about dealing with these. We follow them, but it's hard for me to recommend, Nick, thematically on anything unless you feel particularly strong. Wasn't the marijuana ETF the number one performer in the first quarter, right? What happened to that one?
Yeah, Q1 for MJ was a big snapback from the Q4 meltdown, but it's gone really nowhere since. The names that you're talking about now, I see momentum as being a big theme that has played a big role in markets so far year to date, probably continues in the back half. And then a bit of a dash for trash kind of feel with some of these sort of third tier emerging markets that just got very depressed and now with rates coming down are beginning to lift again.
It's almost like you have to be really, you have to watch really careful to see something badly beaten up and have faith that it's there is some bounce back in it.
Right.
But it's
certainly
an awful lot of effort to spend all day long waiting for, oh, my God, is Argentina going to come back possibly?
Right.
Well,
right.
Maybe not. Maybe
it's
a very hard thing to call on a fundamental basis. It's easier to just stay long or short semiconductors if you believe in the global, China trade rally.
If the tariffs come off,
Yeah, it seems to be easier calls. What about the second half of the year, Nick? What are you telling your clients?
We're telling our clients third quarter is going to get a little choppy because we've baked in so much good news. The good news, ultimately, is that central banks around the world have decided that the neutral rate of interest is a lot lower than they thought it was 6 months ago. 3.5 back then, probably 2.5 now for U.S. neutral rates. That's going to continue to help U.S. and equity valuations. That's the good news. The bad news is we still have trade to deal with. We still have a slowing economy to deal with. We have all those headlines that earned the Fed the need to have to change rate policy. So we're looking for a volatile Q3 and then a little better Q4.
Recession in 2020?
We don't think so.
No,
because
the Fed's going to be, the global central banks are going to be accommodative and there's going to be a deal on trade. That's what everybody says, and that's why there's no recession, no big recession call out there.
Yeah, look, I mean, look at it very simply. There's never been a U.S. recession where oil hasn't doubled first. Now, U.S. is producing a lot more oil, keeping prices down. There could be other factors. That's always been the spark on the tinder that really pushed us over the edge.
Yeah.
We're not going to get that this time.
And theoretically, interest rates are so low if you just span them out and looking into our past. So I don't think you're going to have inflation either. I just think it's what we discussed before, right? It's a bull market that just has some weird feelings to it.
Why is the market at a new high but doesn't feel that way? And don't tell me it's the most hated bull market. We all agree on that.
So many people have always made semi such an important part of their portfolio.
Uh-huh.
And they just never came back off to the December high. They had a little bit, but so many people, we trade Micron a lot for clients, and so many people are trading the calls and options and it just doesn't rally. And what's holding that back are these, longer term calls of chip demand. And I think that was an essential part of other rallies. So you just have to look at other places. If those
come
back,
half of your revenues out of China, where a lot of these semiconductors are, it's a little wonder.
And that's the Q3 volatility around trade we're talking about.
You wrote about this so very eloquently a little while ago in DataTrek. ETF inflows, they are still continuing. They are positive. But there is a notable deceleration in the inflows compared to last year. Are we at peak ETF is the wrong thing to say here. But in terms of inflows, $19 trillion is in mutual funds. We still only have $4 trillion, $3 trillion, $4 trillion in ETFs. It seemed to me like there's plenty of room for growth in ETFs.
No, I would agree with that. I would just think that the growth rate, which used to be, say, $30 billion a month inflows, then became 20, then became 10. We're anything around 10 right now this year on average. That's probably more the sustainable run rate going forward, but it's not going to be that monster growth that we had in the middle part of the decade. It's just going to be more slow and more organic.
Your fee compression as well, I think, is the story there. I still think you'll grow, but with fee compression comes pressure on lack of innovation and putting new products out. The leaders, obviously, we know the leaders still control a lot of the market share. The iShares and the Vanguard control so much of the flow, but there's exciting new ideas, right?
Plain vanilla indexing still rules, but let's talk about some new ones that are out there. Right. Let's move on a bit here. As the 10-year yield has fallen to its lowest level in years, investors are on the hunt for yield, and funds are taking advantage of that trend. The Bell Point Tactical Income ETF, here's a brand new one. The ticker is TBND, as in dog. Launched last week, it's got a portfolio of global equities and bonds focused on income. But look at the mixture here. The real estate ETF, that's IYR, the TIPS bond ETF, the JP Morgan Emerging Markets Bond ETF, that's EMB, and the high yield corporate bond ETF, HYG. Talk about a mishmash here. Andrew, what do you think they're trying to accomplish
really
there?
They're really mixing it up.
Is there something to be said for owning an ETF of ETFs?
I think that's again, there's needs to be new innovation for growth. So someone puts a fund of funds. We've had mutual funds of funds out for decades, right? So this is an ETF fund of funds. Essentially, it's the same thing. But I do agree with you, the mishmash of products, putting the real estate in there, that's obviously going to generate yield, has some risk. Emerging market bonds, we trade a lot of just the EMB itself. That has a ton of volatility and ability to move around. But then you have TIPS, which is Treasury inflation protected. So, you know, the question of like, well, what do you do with rates? Well, that's why the TIPS is in there.
I guess, you know, Nick, my question is, why don't you just own one thing? If you want 4% yield, I mean, why don't you just own one or two things to get you there? I can understand, okay, I don't want to just own high yield. There's too much risk in high yield. If the economy turns down, that's going to go down. So I need to have some ballast by owning TIPS or something. Is that the theory here?
That is the theory. Diversification sort of writ large in the fixed income world is what this fund is trying to accomplish. This fund is for somebody that only wants to see one or two symbols on their brokerage statements. They want to see a bond, an income portion. They want to see an equity portion, and just leave it at that.
I would agree with that, because there's a story for why each one could go up or down. So you are diversifying if you have them as a basket.
So you don't have any problem with the ETFs of ETFs, then? They're
no,
okay for you?
They're fund of funds.
Okay. I guess my question is, you know, sometimes it's easier to just, you could own eight stock ETFs, and ultimately, if you just own Vanguard total stock, you get the same return as owning
eight stock ETFs,
and then everybody looks at you as, why are you owning eight ETFs when you can own one and get the same essential return?
Right.
Or am I crazy?
I mean, you can get alpha, but you're right. The downside of the fund of funds is you're paying a higher expense fee, right? You told me it was 60 bips, to own that. So.
All right, let's move on here. I want to get to buybacks, another theme this year. Buybacks, already on track to smash records in 2019. Janet Johnson of TrimTabs with us now. She's got a way to play buybacks using exchange-traded funds. And, of course, we're at records still. Buybacks still getting record inflows here. Janet, how does TrimTabs set up an ETF with buybacks in them?
Well, we think they're good buybacks and bad buybacks. So we like the companies that have organic growth. So they have free cash flow growth. And we also look at their balance sheets to see how leveraged they are, if they're improving or not. And those are the buybacks that tend to deliver alpha. So we do have a fund, TTAC, that does deliver alpha over the major market.
So this is very interesting. You're not just going out and buying companies that are, for example, reducing their share count the most, which would be, you know, I call the buyback monsters, the companies that do 4 or 5% reductions. You actually have a sort of a rules-based method. Growing free cash flow, strong balance sheet, and then you factor in share count reduction. And you've got, I see here, the top 10 are about 14%. It's a pretty diverse group, but you've got Zoetis, Illumina, MSCI, Deckers Outdoor that meet this criteria.
We're an all-cap fund. We're equal-weighted. We have 100 names. We think of ourselves in the high-quality space. We're basically looking at profitability, organic growth, strong balance sheets with a little bit of share reduction. As active managers, we're also looking for most.
You think that outperforms. So you do have a competitor out there, the PKW, and they've been around for a while. They basically go out and buy shares of companies that are actively trying to reduce their share count. So this has been around for a while. They have Citigroup, Cisco, Oracle, Apple. They're 5% of them. All of these companies have been reducing their share count aggressively for many, many years. That seems a more pure play on the buybacks. Is it your contention that doing it your way, throwing in buyback reduction along with growing free cash flow and strong balance sheet, that that does better than just buying this?
We think that not all buybacks lead to riches. And also, I could be wrong, but I think with PKW, they're looking at trailing 12-month. We look at actual share reduction, because we don't really care what a company says or what they've done in the past. We look at what they're doing in real time.
Yeah, their methodology is they repurchase the companies that they own at least 5% of their shares in the previous 12 months. So it was announced. They did actually do it. But your point is that your methodology might produce a superior alpha.
We look at what they're doing now, not what they did yesterday.
I actually think you have a chance to have a new kind of category in investing, which I like. I read an article in CNBC over the weekend about where has value investing gone.
Yeah.
And it's obviously because there's so much attention to growth. But these are quality companies.
When
you go back at original, Berkshire Hathaway's definition of that, it was quality companies that were just trading at a low multiple. Now, you're not factoring multiple, but they're all the other things that make them quality companies, and then you could add some growth into that. So maybe this can be the new kind of value.
Our companies tend to have organic growth. If you look at our portfolio, we're all cap. We're right in the middle in terms of companies that are categorized as value or growth.
Right.
But they have organic growth. I personally, in this environment where, is it Goldilocks or crisis? Headline crisis. I am a big fan of moats, so we're also looking for other protective layers to add. So you're right, it's a high quality.
And Nick, how do you feel about, you've written about buybacks before. I mean, all things being equal, if all other things on an income statement being the same, a 5% reduction in the share count outstanding does improve your earnings by 5%. So there is something to this idea.
There absolutely is. And more than anything, it shows respect for the shareholder. A buyback shows the company's just not going to waste capital on M&A or a bad investment. They really value shareholder capital, and they will hand it back when they can't use it.
We got to run. But do you want to pay the same multiple for a company just buying back their stock as you do for, say, real organic growth? Nick? Janet?
You know, we will look at other fundamentals, but as all of you they've been talking a lot in the news. Value has underperformed not just for years, but for a long time period.
Yeah.
And it depends on how you define it.
Yeah.
So
I would pay a higher multiple for growth over just companies buying back stock. That just makes sense to me as a growth guy overall. We got to go, folks. That does it for this week's ETF Edge. I'm Bob Pisani. My thanks to Janet, Nick, and Andrew for joining us today. And thank you for watching. You can find all of our latest videos right here on our website, etfedge.cnbc.com. We'll see you next Monday, same time, same place. Have a good week.
Thank you.
The ABCs of ETFs with the ETF Edge newsletter. Your weekly update on the hottest trends in the nearly $4 trillion market of exchange-traded funds. Expert analysis, actionable ideas, and exclusive insight from host Bob Pisani. Sign up now at cnbc.com/ETF Edge newsletter.